feet, I belong to God. And then somebody had the audacity, choir members and music ministry, and many of you out there had the audacity to be happy about that and to rejoice that you belong to God. Amen. Songwriter some time ago said that I'm glad that man didn't make me. Y'all remember that song? I'm glad that man didn't create me, because he would surely forsake me. But since I belong to God, he'll never leave me nor forsake me. I rejoice in the fact that I belong to God. Amen. 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 That's befitting for what we're going to talk about today. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. We thank God for all of you who are here. I'm certainly thank God for our worship leader, Brother Dio, for the pastors and preachers who accompany us in the pulpit, Pastor Isom and our Christian Education Director, Reverend McCruel, and to all of you, my brothers and sisters in Christ and in creation, if you're here, we are glad to be here. Glad for all of our guests and our visitors today. Some faces we haven't seen in a while. We're not going to call nobody out. And then some brand new faces that we've never seen. We are grateful that you chose Pleasant Green. You had a whole host of places that you could have worshiped today. We are truly grateful that you chose us. Now, in the book of Matthew, Matthew 25, 25th chapter of the book of Matthew is a parable we want to talk about. And certainly one that we are familiar with. And we want to talk about it again to bring it back into our remembrance that we might glean from it some important principles that we might apply in our relationship with God and as we walk and journey with one another. Matthew chapter 25, I'm going to read verses 14 through 18 in your hearing from the New International Version of the Bible. I'm going to ask that you read all of Matthew chapter 25 when you get an opportunity at your earliest convenience, because it does make up the background of what we're going to be talking about today. I don't mean to be here before you long. I know I say that every Sunday. Amen. But it is not my intent. We are grateful that this is the Lord's Supper. Amen. Amen. We want to worship not only in the Word, but we want to worship at the table. Amen. 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 Now, in Matthew chapter 25, verses 14 through 18, from the New International Version of the Bible, this is what the word says. Again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. To one he gave 5 bags of gold, to another 2 bags, and to another 1 bag. Each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey, and the man who had received 5 bags of gold went at once, put his money to work, gained 5 bags more. So also the one who won with 2 bags of gold gained 2 more. But the man who had received 1 bag went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money.
Yes, sir.
Just for a few minutes, by the grace of God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, I want to talk to you from the subject, managing the material. Managing the material. Amen. If that doesn't fit right now, give me a minute. Managing the material. Amen. Would you pray with me? Would you pray with me? Amen. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for your goodness, grace, and mercy toward us. We thank you for what we have already experienced in worship, and manifestation of your spirit through the singing, through the prayers, through the praise. We are grateful for all that has been done and all you have allowed to be done in your name. Now, as we get ready to worship in the word, we ask that you would take us a little bit higher as it relates to our understanding about your word and your will for our lives. We pray, oh God, that you would empower us to preach with boldness, with wisdom, and with passion. Pray, O God, that you let the words of my mouth, the meditation of all my hearts, be acceptable in your sight. For Lord, you are strength and our Redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray, and every heart say, amen.
Amen.
Managing the material. Managing the material. Jesus is talking about, in this parable, money, but money really represents all the material resources that God has placed in our possession and under our care. Are y'all gonna pray with me? And one writer says that Jesus talks 20 times more about material resources, money in particular, 20 times more than he does what many of us would call spiritual things. He talks 20 times more about material things, in particular money, than he talks about faith, than he talks about prayer, than he talks about those things that we would call spiritual. Are y'all praying with me?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And what that tells us, and what we should come away with our understanding is that everything has a spiritual connection.
Right.
Even our material resources and our money have a spiritual connection.
Right.
If you pray with me, I won't be long. Everything has a spiritual connection, a spiritual application, and spiritual implications. Therefore, everything really is spiritual, even our money. And so it's no wonder that our mindset with the material, our mindset with money, is what messes us up most of the time when it comes to our relationship with God. And when it comes to our family relationships and our community, it's our mindset toward the material. Are y'all gonna pray with me? So Jesus helps us out in the text that I read to you in order for us to understand how to properly apply the principles of our faith as it relates to the use of material resources that are given to us by God. And thank God, God is a gracious and generous God.
Yes, sir.
I ought to be able to get a witness in here that God is a generous and gracious God. How do you know that, preacher? Well, with all the other things that he gives us, woke us up this morning, started us on our way, blessed us with food on our table, clothes on our backs, shoes on our feet, a mode of transportation to get to where we desire to go, put our minds focused on him so that we ended up in the house of God, among the saints of God, on the Lord's day. I'm glad to witness in here. God is gracious, but with all of that that he gives us, he still gave us Jesus. And that's how I know that God is gracious, because he gave us Jesus, and he sent Jesus to die on the cross so that our sins might be forgiven. Are y'all gonna pray with me? He's gracious and generous. Matter of fact, we got saved because of God's grace. Is there a witness in the house that we are saved by grace through faith and not that of yourselves? It is the gift of God, not by works, lest any man should boast. God is gracious. Are y'all gonna pray with me? And that even though we are stingy and we are stained and we are filled with sin, come on somebody, God commended his love toward us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. God is generous and gracious, said he commended his love toward us, that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. He's generous and gracious, I tell you. Are y'all gonna pray with me? That if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart, God are saved, God is generous and gracious. I'm so glad that he's generous and gracious, that even though he sent us Jesus to die on the cross, don't you overlook the fact that before Jesus died, he lived for 33 years. And for 33 years, he showed us how to live in right relationship with God. He showed us how to be children of God. He showed us what it means to have a relationship with the Father. Are y'all praying with me? He's a model for our lives so that we might look at Jesus and then live our lives according to his example. Are y'all praying with me? He offered us this resource through his son, Jesus Christ, not only in his death, but also in his life. And he, in his life, he teaches us how to manage the material. He teaches us how to manage money. And we all can learn something about how to manage our material, how to manage our money. I know we don't like nobody to tell us how to handle our money. We had last year, we had a course that was offered at Pleasant Green, and you didn't have to pay a dime. All you had to do was come in. The course was on personal financial management. And Sister Cecilia Creighton did a marvelous job in presenting biblical principles to teach us how to manage our wealth and manage our money and manage our resources. And you would think that with a significant course like that, we wouldn't have had enough room for all the people who would have come to learn something about how to do better with your money. Amen. But that's not how it was. Amen. We had plenty of space. And I'm telling you, I was one of the folks sitting in the class, and I was blessed beyond measure. I learned so much in that class about how to handle the material resources that God has given me so that God can bless me even more abundantly than he already has. And he has been good already. Are y'all going to pray with me? But what I found is that most of us, we don't want nobody to tell us how to manage our money. We don't think we need to be strategic. We don't think we need to be tactical. We don't think we need to be disciplined. We don't think we need to live on a budget. Come on, somebody. We don't want nobody because what's going to happen is we're going to hit the lottery and all our problems going to be gone. I wish I had a witness in here. Somebody going to die and leave us a whole lot of money, and we ain't going to never have a problem with money again. I know that's publishing Clearinghouse is coming around the corner to knock on your door to let you know you have won $10 million. And so we don't want to be strategic. We don't want to invest. We don't want to do nothing. Just wait for our pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. I know that sounds crazy, don't it? But that's how many of us live. But what I'm trying to say is that God has given us an example on how to handle the material resources and the blessing. It ain't just your money, baby, but it's everything that he's given you. Are y'all praying? Because look what the text says. The text says, I bring that up because in the text, Jesus says that there was a wealthy man. And the Bible says that he went into a far country, but he left his wealth, material wealth, with his servants. He gave one 5 bags of gold. He gave another 2 bags of gold. Then he gave a third 1 bag of gold according to their ability. Are y'all going to pray with me? And it helps me to understand some things. And there's 3 things I want to share out of this text that will help us to be better at managing our resources. Don't go to sleep on me. I got 3 things and I'm going to let you go. He said, first of all, you need to learn how to manage your revelation.
All right. Yeah.
Because there is a revelation in this parable, in this text that I read in your hearing. There is a revelation. And the revelation is what the choir was singing a few minutes ago. I belong to God. In other words, the revelation is everything belongs to God. Not just you, baby, but the person sitting next to you. Not just you and the person sitting next to you, but the pew you're sitting on. I wish I had a witness. Not just you and the pew, but the floor you got your feet on. I wish I had a witness. man left his material wealth and he went away into another country for a long time. Come on, somebody. But even though he wasn't there, when he gave them the wealth, it didn't belong to them. It was in their possession. Are y'all praying with me? In other words, everything that you have belongs to God. Everything that you have, and from the top of your head to the soles of your feet, and everything in between belongs to God. The job that you go to tomorrow morning, the check that you go pick up on Friday, all of that belongs to God. The house that you live in, the car that you drove here in, it all belongs to God. Are y'all gonna pray with me? That and how we manage that revelation will determine how we manage the resources that God has given us. Are y'all praying with me? The Bible says he gave his servants his wealth. It didn't mean that it belonged to them. It still belonged to the rich man. Are y'all praying with me? And that's how the kingdom of God is. Even though you can't see God, God is real and he has left his resources in our hands.
Yes, sir.
His servants, one bag. He gave somebody one bag of gold.
Yes, sir.
He gave somebody else two bags and he gave another five bags. Well, preacher, if it belongs to God, why do I have it? Well, it's because it's a known fact that you can possess something and still not own it. Y'all just had 5 minutes in the sermon. You, that house you live in, you possess it, but the bank has the deed on it. I wish I had a witness. That car you drove here in, if you're still paying notes like I am, you possess it, but the bank has the title on it. And everything in between, you can possess it, but somebody else can still own it. He gave one bag to one, two bags to another, five bags to another, one, two, and five. He gave it to them according to their ability. And so it is with God. God gives us his stuff according to our ability. God is not going to give us what we are unable to manage. That's why I'm not mad at Warren Buffett. I'm not mad at Bill Gates. I'm not mad at Oprah Winfrey. Somebody say, Oprah Winfrey is worth $2.2 billion. I ain't mad at her. I'm not mad at her because God has given to her according to her ability. Are y'all going to pray with me? Yeah. And some of us are saying, well, if he gave her $2.2 billion, he ought to at least be able to give me $200,000. Are y'all praying with me? What is $200,000 compared to $2.2 billion? Are y'all praying with me? Well, God gives us according to our ability. And it's no sense in us asking for $200,000 if we can't handle $25,000. Because he gave you $25,000 last year and you jacked it up. I wish I had a witness. Because some of us are complaining that we have a little. But what you do with a little is what you're going to do with a lot. That's a principle, baby. Look, whatever you do with a little, that's the very same stuff you're going to do with a little. He gave you $25,000. That's a little. And what you do with your little, you took it to the club. With your little, you went to the club with your little. You bought a round of drinks for everybody in your pocket. With a little. Come on, somebody. You might as well say amen. You up in there trying to make it rain with $5 bills. With a little. Are y'all going to pray with me? That's what you did with a little. And you drank up a little. You snorted up a little. trying to say. We have this aversion when it comes to our faith and money, that our faith and our money can't be together in one principle. We have many Christians not only with our money but with all of our material things, including our body. We have a dichotomy of the secular. We don't understand that everything is spiritual. Your physical body has spiritual implications and applications. Are y'all praying with me? It's all connected. And what happens is we have this secular dichotomy. In other words, we've got one set of principles for the spiritual and then another set of principles for the material. We're one way on Sunday. We're another way on Friday. We have one mentality for our worship, but then we have a whole lot of a different mentality, a secular mentality, when it comes to our everyday life. Are y'all gonna pray with me? I'm just trying to preach. I'm just trying to say what I'm trying to say. We have this dichotomy. We have a public persona, and then we have a private personality. And they are separate. One is spiritual, the other is secular. We've got one set of rules for our faith. We got another set of rules for our Facebook page. Y'all gonna give me in a minute. We have this dichotomy between the spiritual and the secular. But we ain't two people. We are one person. Are y'all gonna pray with me? And because we're one person, we need to know that everything that is physical and material comes out of a spiritual disposition. And so if I really have faith in God and I really trust God, it's going to show up in the decisions that I make and the money that I make and the money that I spend. I wish I had a witness. And the material resources that I use will all manifest who I am as a spiritual person in Jesus Christ. Wow, he says that we need to manage our revelation, but we also need to manage expectations.
All right.
We are in a spiritual journey from the top of our head to the bottom of our feet. Everything belongs to God, and we need to manage that revelation, but Jesus says we need to manage our expectations. And the reason we need to manage our expectations is in the text. I'm going to show it to you in a minute. The reason we need to manage our expectations is because there is an inspection that's coming. God has given us his material resources, and he has expectations as it relates to what he has given us. Are y'all praying with me? The text says that he gave one bag of gold, another two bags of gold, and a third five bags of gold.
All right.
He left, but then the Bible said he came back.
Yes, sir.
He put it, the Bible says that the man with five bags put the money to work, and he got five more bags in return.
Yes, sir.
The one who had two put the money to work, and then he got two more bags in return.
Yes, sir.
So the one who had five now has ten. One who had two now has four.
Right.
But then the third servant, the Bible says that the man gave him one bag, and he dug a hole and hid his master's resources.
Yes,
are y'all gonna pray with me?
Right.
Then made excuses when the master came to inspect what they had done with the material resources he had placed in their possession.
Yes,
I'm almost done.
Yes,
but before I leave you, I gotta tell you that the reason we need to manage God's expectations is because he has an inspection on the way to see what you have done with the man with the resources he has placed in your hands. There is an inspection coming, because I found out that you can't just expect folk to do stuff. You have to inspect what they're going to do in order for you to expect the right outcome. There has to be an inspection with the expectations. At our house, 2609, we are in the process of managing. encouraging and molding young minds in order to that they might adopt a functional work ethic, discipline and self-discipline in order to do the jobs that is assigned well. Are y'all praying with me? We're teaching how to be meticulous in what you do. So you only have to do it one time. Come on. That's what's going on in our house. And so we are in the process of developing that self-discipline to do things right the first time. And to engender a work ethic in individuals so that even when folk ain't around and watching, the job gets done the way it's supposed to be done. But what I learned, see, because I ain't new to this parental thing, we have five children. Three came in one wave, two came in the second wave. So I take what I learned in the first wave and apply it in the second wave. You'll get this on the way home, but I gotta tell you that what I learned with the first three, I apply with the two. And what happens is I learned that people are only gonna do right what you expect. You can't just say it and expect it to get done. You gotta go back behind them and inspect what they have done in order to understand and make sure that they have done what you told them to do. And that's what's going on in the kingdom of heaven, that God has given us material resources, gave you a voice, and gave you hands, and gave you feet, and he gave you a heart and a mind, and a rational mind, gave you resources, and he's inspecting what you're doing so that his expectations will be met for what you're supposed to be. Are you going to pray with me? He's watching you when you're sitting in there, and everybody, he's got their hands up and on their feet praising and giving him worship and open their mouths and giving him praise. And you sitting there like you've been sucking on a lemon all night long. But I want you to know, baby, that God has some expectations. He said, let everything that have breath give praise unto from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same. His name is worthy to be praised. He's inspecting. But I'm so glad that one day there's going to be a big inspection. And you know, a lot of times folks don't want to be a part of the church. They said, because I'm just under too much scrutiny at the church. They're too judgmental at the church. Well, if we're too judgmental here, baby, don't go to heaven. Because when you go to heaven, there's something called a judgment seat of Christ, where every thought and every word and every deed will come under Christ's scrutiny. And we have to give an account for what we have done in these bodies. We have to manage his expectation by doing it his way. Are y'all praying with me? In word, in thought, and in deed. Bible says he's coming back one day. He's coming with his reward in his hands. And he's going to judge the quick and the dead. And all of us who are in Christ have to stand before his judgment seat in order to give an account for what we have done as believers in Christ. Are y'all praying with me? He's coming back, and those that have not even don't have anything to offer back to the master as on his investment of resources into our possessions. The Bible says that those who have will be given more. That's in the text.
Yes, sir.
Those who don't have, the very thing they have will be taken away.
Amen.
Scripture says that the man who had five bags of gold, the master said, well done, good and faithful servant. Man who had two bags, but now he's got four. The master said, well done, good and faithful servant. But to the one who was lazy and slothful, that's what the scripture said, evil and lazy servants. For those who are evil and lazy, the Bible says that what you have will be taken away and given to those church that had a witness in this house who already have and who have been faithful over what the possessions and the blessings that God has given them. Are y'all going to pray with me? And somebody said, well, why would he take from what you have to give to somebody who has already? Well, you know how that works. That's a principle in finances and financial management. One of the things that happens is you got a credit card and the person next to you may have the same car, but the person next to you pays on time.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you don't have to call them or look for them or encourage them. They pay on time. Are y'all praying with me? And then they manage that card in such a way that it shows fiscal responsibility. And so what happens is after a while they send them a letter and say, you've been so good managing your car. Your limit was 1,000. Now it's 3,000.
Yeah.
Are y'all praying with me?
Yes,
giving to those who already have. But you pay when you feel like it. And when the people call, you look at the phone and see who's calling. Won't even talk to them. Answer your cell phone. They got your cell phone. And then you answer your cell phone. They say, may I speak to so-and-so? She ain't here. What do you mean she ain't here? This is a cell phone. Are y'all praying with me? In other words, you do whatever you think. You get mad when you go to the store and the card won't work. And then get hot, call the people up. And I wish I had a witness in here. And so next thing you know, now they tell you your card did have $1,000 in it. Now you got $250. I wish I had a witness. Because they will take from those who don't have anything and give to those who have some already. Kingdom of heaven. But before I leave you, you need to manage the expectations that God has, because an inspection is coming. Finally, you need to manage the compensation, because our God is a God who rewards those who do it his way. And that's without you giving anything. If you do it his way, God will reward you. I got about 2 minutes. I'm going to use it wisely and share with you that God will reward you for managing not only your money, his money, but the resources he has placed in your hands. Managing your children, managing your time, managing your labor, managing your schedule. Because sometimes we can fill our schedule with everything but worship, and with everything but serving God, with everything but being accountable to what God's expectations are for the resources he has provided. And he has blessed us abundantly. I know that you have a little, but maybe there's some folks don't have anything. Are you praying with me? Yeah, there's some folks who don't have nothing. Don't know where they're going to get their food this evening. But the Lord has blessed so many of us. That we handle what he has placed in our possession his way. And if we do it his way, there is compensation.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm not trying. I know a lot of folks, when I started about this parable, you turned me off. You didn't want to hear it, because here we go. He's trying to talk about money. But I ain't just talking about money. I'm talking about resources. Because God knows where your heart is. He knows your spiritual disposition by what you do with the things that he gives you. Are y'all praying with me? He knows already where you're coming from based on what you do with the resources he has placed in your possession. And he compensates us according to the way we faithfully use as stewards what he has given us. What I'm trying to do is not get you to give something to the church. I'm not trying to get you to do that. I'm trying to get you in a position where God can give something to you. I'm not trying to get anything. That's why a lot of folks say, I don't want to be in the church, because all they're trying to do is get your money. But I want to tell you, baby, I'm trying to help you get something from God. That's why I'm talking to you about your material resources and how to manage them. Because God says, if you handle is holy unto the Lord. If you want to do it God's way, he who sows sparingly will reap sparingly. He who sows bountifully will reap bountifully. Give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, in give into your bosom. The songwriter said you can't be God-given. No matter how hard you try, the more you give, the more he gives to you. Just keep on giving. You'll find it's really true that you can't be God-given no matter how hard you try. I know I'm losing you, but let me take you home on this illustration. There was a woman by the name of Mary Kay who lived in Texas. Mary Kay, y'all know Mary Kay. Mary Kay is a Christian woman who passed away not long ago, but she was a Christian woman, and she made millions for herself, and she made millions for a lot of other women, and she empowered them to go into business for themselves. Y'all know Mary Kay, that's the pink Cadillacs you see riding around, because after you sell so much of Mary Kay products, you get a pink Cadillac. I know that ain't my style, but somebody in here, you drive that pink Cadillac. But let me tell you about Mary Kay. Mary Kay is a Christian woman, and she was a tither, and she let everybody know that I'm blessed because I give unto God, and I honor God with the material resources he's placed under my control. Well, Mary Kay had a testimony, but not only did she have a verbal testimony, she had a physical testimony, because she wore around her neck everywhere she went a gold chain, and on the end of the gold chain there was a big gold shovel and a little gold shovel, and so she used it in order to start conversations with people who would be intrigued by the two shovels that she wore. And whenever they asked Mary, why you wear these two gold shovels, one big one and one little one, she said, I'll tell you what happened. She says, the little shovel is my shovel. The big shovel is God's shovel. When I shovel to God with my little shovel, he shovels back to me with y'all.